Good morning, or good afternoon, or maybe good evening. It's hard to say because we have a special situation. As a matter of fact, we are supposed to be here for the CM conference, but at this moment I am here. And you are somewhere out there. Anyway, wherever you are, welcome to the CM conference and welcome to the Robot Evolution keynote. My name is Gus Eyben. I am an AI professor on the Vrije Universiteit Amsterdam and a visiting professor on the University of York. Without further ado, let me kick off with a video fragment.
Twee robots die zich voortplanten. Dat klinkt als science fiction, maar de eerste robotbaby is een feit. Een hoogleraar uit Amsterdam onthult op het Tech Festival in Utrecht het eerste exemplaar. En wat bijzonder is, het is geen kloon, een exacte kopie, maar zelfs een betere versie dan zijn ouders.
In case you don't live in the Netherlands, so this is primetime Dutch TV news, and this is a very well-known anchorman. So this was quite an interesting media stunt for the university and the research group. This is why everybody asked me the next morning, was it just a media stunt, or is there some deeper scientific vision behind it? And the answer is, actually, it's both. I don't have to explain the relevance of the media, but I have to explain the scientific vision. So the vision is the following. Given the fact that evolution can create intelligence, it is very plausible that artificial evolution can create artificial intelligence. Which raises the big question, can we really evolve intelligence? If we could. We could use this technology for engineering better robots, for applications which are currently out of reach. And we could also do some different kind of science, investigating deep scientific questions about the evolution of life, evolution of intelligence. To this end, it's really important to notice that intelligence is a property of behavior. It's not a body that is intelligent or a single brain. It's always the environment, the body and the brain that together induce a behavior that can be intelligent or not. And there is a narrow version or narrow notion of intelligence that seeks it solely in the brain. And there is a broad notion of intelligence which seeks it in the combination of the body and the brain. So indeed, we have to have a holistic picture. And for intelligent behavior, we need a body and a brain, or in technical terms, hardware and software. This dichotomy is also visible in the history of artificial intelligence. In the 20th century, AI was mainly concerned with thinking machines. And the grand challenge that was leading research and development was to build an artificial system that could equal or actually beat humans in a task which requires the most intelligence of humans. And this was identified as playing chess. And sure enough, 3 years before the end of the century, IBM's Deep Blue computer won from the chess world champion of chess. This was the era of digital AI. Digital AI is here to stay. It will never go away. But in the 21st century, there is another stream coming up next to it, which is the research line of embodied AI. This is not concerned with thinking machines only, it is concerned with acting and interacting machines. And also here we have an iconic grand challenge, and that is to build an artificial system that beats humans in a task which requires even more intelligence than chess, and that is football. This is why we have the RoboCup competition every year, robots playing football among themselves. So putting everything in this perspective, the question becomes, can we evolve embodied intelligence? And embodied intelligence brings us immediately to robots. So robots are officially defined as a combination of some sensors, information processing unit, and actuators. But when you look at the existing robots, you can see that there are an awful lot of different robots. There are industrial robots that are stationary and hidden in some factory. There are humanoid robots that we know from the science fiction movies. There are actually non-robots in hospitals, the surgical robots that just simply amplify the capabilities of a human surgeon without autonomy. There are little robots in many households doing specific tasks, for instance, vacuum cleaning. And there are autonomous vehicles that are bizarre. They don't feel like a robot because we can sit in them. But sure enough, they have sensors, they have information processing units, and they have actuators. And last but not least, we have my favorite type, which is the academic research robot, that is not built to do anything useful. It is solely for research purposes. This diversity of robot forms already indicates how hard a design problem is. So when you want to design robots for a specific application, like playing football, you have an awful lot of options to choose an optimal body. And once you settle on a body form, you have to design the brain that can drive and manipulate and control that body form. So here we have a lot of choices. We could be anthropochauvinists. We could demand that a robot football player looks like a human football player. We could be a bit more broad-minded and note that 4 feet for playing football could be better than 2 feet. Then we will end up with little dog-like robots that could play football. Or we can even be more open-minded, radical, and say that we don't even need feet for football. Robots that are driving around and kick the ball around and get it into the goal of the opponent, they are good enough. So the design problems are hard. The design problems are huge because the search spaces are big. This makes us wonder, can we copy someone? Can we copy something? What is or who is the best designer we know of? And the best designer we know of is evolution. Considering that life on Earth has successfully populated all environmental niches, we can observe that evolution is indeed a very successful designer. So the idea here is to convert the principles of natural evolution and come up with an artificial version. How long does it take to get there? The answer is, we are already there. There is an art slash science of evolutionary computing with a seminal book from 2003. And that is not that difficult to see that problem solving in a formal mathematical computer science or design context can be related to natural evolution by just simply 3 pages. Let me illustrate how this works using an example, a well-known problem of the traveling salesman, who has to visit a couple of cities and return to its location of origin using the shortest time or the shortest path or the least fuel. So for this traveling salesman, we can evolve a solution by simply making 3 decisions. Decision number 1 is identify the individuals. And in a biologically evolving population, individuals are animals like rabbits on an island. In a formal context, it will be a candidate solution that may or may not be optimal. And here you see one which is certainly not the shortest, so it is not optimal. After this, the second step or bridge we have to make is selection. In nature, selection is represented by weather conditions, food shortages, predators, or other rabbits that are fighting for the same resources. In artificial evolution, it's the designer or the user that postulates what is fitness and what is good and what is quality. Here we will say fitness is related to length. Short is good, long is bad. Last but not least, we have the digital equivalence of reproduction. So we need something like digital sex, which looks like this. If you have 2 parents, a red one and a blue one, that play the role of the mother and the father, we could cross them over, recombine them, and produce a 3rd individual, which could be called their child, their offspring. And in this example, you see that neither mom nor dad were optimal because they had a loop, which makes them unnecessarily long. And this poor child inherits the worst from both parents. So in normal common terms, we could say if one of the parents was intelligent and the other was beautiful, then this child is ugly and stupid. This is, of course, not that bad because evolution always creates a surplus of individuals and we have selection to get rid of the bad ones and only keep the good ones. Based on this, evolutionary computing has been applied to a lot of different problems in optimization and design. Evolutionary design is the most relevant line of research for robot evolution. And evolutionary design has delivered surprising, original, creative solutions to hard engineering problems. Here are three examples. For instance, you can see a jet nozzle in the middle, which was optimized for some industrial target. And the solution itself is somehow strange, bizarre. It is not really symmetrical. It is nothing a real human designer would ever come up with. But it optimizes what it has to optimize. On the right-hand side, there is another example of a satellite antenna. This is a more recent example, and this is my favorite because it has actually been fabricated, put on a spaceship, and as we speak, it is now on its way to Mars. And also for this, it holds that the solution is completely strange. The shape, the form, the length of those arms are very irregular. It is nothing human designers would come up with. From evolutionary design, it's a small step to evolutionary robotics. And evolutionary robotics is also not a new idea per se. The classic book of Nolfi and Floriano is already from 2000. So what does it do? How does it work? Let me illustrate it with a video. This video fragment illustrates research into designing brains or controllers for different robot forms or life forms, if you will. The challenge here is that the bodies are very complex. They have many degrees of freedom, complex interactions around the modules, and there is no analytical model that we could use. In this case, evolution is your friend. And as you can see here, evolution is capable of designing or finding a brain that can drive any given body, no matter how strange or how it is composed, for straight walking in a line. This is all very interesting, but it is only simulation. We wanted to evolve real robots in the physical world. Is that also possible? The answer is not quite. This is a paper, which is also a classic from 2000, that used artificial evolution in a computer simulation and physically fabricated and manufactured the end result. So once again, evolution was digital, but the result was physical. This may seem as a good idea, but actually this is running into a very serious problem known as the reality gap. The reality gap is a well-known phenomenon, and it stands for the difference between the behavior of an evolved robot in simulation and in the real world. The difference can be very big, and typically the real world behavior is much worse than the simulated behavior. So this means that simulations have only limited applicability. We really need to evolve robots in the physical world. So the question is not, can we evolve robots, but can we evolve real robots? And if you think back on that concept of evolution, the two pillars are selection and reproduction. And selection is the easy part here, because really, robots are typically made for some task, and task performance can be typically quantified and used as a fitness measure. A robot that performs well will have many children, and a robot that performs poorly will not. So the big question, whether robots can evolve, boils down to whether robots can reproduce. In common parlance, can robots have children? The answer is yes. And in hindsight, it only takes two ideas to get there. These two ideas are the following. Idea number one, look at nature and copy a trick in nature. And the trick there is that every living being has two levels of existence. Every being, including yourself, has a genotype, which is the DNA that encodes you, and a phenotype, which is you, the materialization or the incarnation of the genotype. For robots, we can do the same, and their genotype, the artificial DNA, will be the specification sheet. And the robot that is built to those specifications is the phenotype. The second idea is even more simple, and that is, let us use 3D printing to convert a genotype into a phenotype. If we put this all together, we arrive to an overall system architecture that has been published already in 2013 under the name of the Triangle of Life. This triangle actually captures a robotic life cycle. And this life cycle doesn't run from birth to death, because that would not be a cycle. It runs from conception, being conceived, to conception, conceiving your own offspring. So it starts with a digital DNA that enters the first stage, the morphogenesis. This is where 3D printers, automatic assemblers, or human hands build a robot that is encoded by the genotype. When this robot physically is produced and ready, it is delivered to the real world. This is the moment of birth of a robot baby. Then this robot baby starts the second side of the triangle, the second stage of life, infancy. And in this stage, a robot baby undergoes a learning process. It learns how to control its body, which is new and novel. It is a combination of the two parents, or a mutation of an existing parent, and there is no control strategy known for it. If the robot baby successfully conducts this stage and proves by an examination that it can perform well, it is declared to be a fertile adult. Otherwise, it is removed and recycled. Fertile adults enter the third and last stage of the triangle of life, mature life. This is the stage of survival, mating, learning, task execution. And if this robot is lucky enough to reproduce, it will make another artificial DNA, another genotype, which starts another life cycle. So this is all well, but rather than rushing on and making this technology work as soon as we can, we should also think about the ethical dimensions. And the ethical dimension is related to the danger of runaway evolution. If we had a robot population reproducing out there in the wild without any human control, would it be safe or not? The answer is, we can make it safe. We could exclude solutions that we know from nature, and we could deliberately consider and reject the robotic equivalent of cell division, the robotic equivalent of laying eggs, or the robotic equivalent of pregnancy, because all these reproduction mechanisms are distributed reproduction mechanisms. This means that robots could reproduce anywhere and everywhere. What we really need is a kill switch that can stop the process of reproduction and thereby the process of evolution. So the technical solution to this is, rather than a distributed robot reproduction mechanisms, we need a centralized and externalized reproduction. Putting it all together, we arrive to the notion of an evosphere. And the evosphere is a tangible implementation of the triangle of life concept. It has all the components. It has a production center or birth clinic where the robot babies are made. It has a training center or robot school where the newborn robots undergo the supervised learning process. And it has an arena which represents the outside world. It also has a recycling facility, and it also has cameras or other kind of instruments that help us observe the system behavior and analyze it later. And importantly, it also has a kill switch. The kill switch is the production center itself. If we shut that down, reproduction will stop, meaning evolution will stop. And that's exactly what we may need to do in a certain situation. It doesn't mean that all robots immediately drop down dead. We may need to capture them and bring them home to stop the whole system from working, but at least there will not be new robots anymore. This is the theory. This is the future vision. What is the practice? To show you what the practice is, let me show a video which I made with my own phone in Cambridge in a robot lab, where they had a system which I would describe as the first implementation of a fully automated robotic birth clinic. So the robots here are very abstract robots. They are composed from two kinds of blocks, white blocks and black blocks. And as you see, they are attached to each other with a yellow glue, which we just saw. And one of them, the white blocks, are also actuated. One side of this cube is actuated and can rotate, and that produces a movement or a locomotion in the full robot. So this robotic arm, which they call the mother robot in the related publication, produces a physical object based on a plan, the genotype, and then when it is finished with producing this object, you could say it created a robot baby and brings the robot baby outside of the birth clinic and puts it down, which is the outside world. This is what happens. So this is a very interesting application, but the robots are not really complicated. The evolutionary process is not really complicated, but it is a very important step towards a long vision. So this happened in Cambridge. What happened in Amsterdam? Let me show that with another video.
Body design is introduced from the work of Josh Auerbach from Switzerland. Most of the body parts are 3D printable, but some of them need to be assembled together with those components so we can have a fully functional robot.
So as a biologist, I'm interested in the evolution of form and function. The robot lab is an opportunity and a technology for us as evolutionary biologists to study fundamental processes.
A robot is born, if you will. It may sound a bit funny, but a new robot is instantiated from the genomes of its parents. So its parents have exchanged genomes, just as you would if you had sex in nature, right? And that is used to build a new robot.
When they evaluate each other favorably, they send their genomes through the Wi-Fi network. Sexual reproduction mechanism then creates new genome. Code of this genome is sent to the 3D printer then for printing new components.
On the 19th of February 2016, the first robot baby was born. In our labs, a couple of hand-designed robots that were walking in the arena, they physically came close, they met, if you will,
and then it happened. They decided to have a child. So there it was, the first family in 2016, and this is what made national television. So the two systems, the one in Cambridge and the one in Amsterdam, share a lot of properties. They are both evolutionary robot systems, and they are both real-world systems, but they have very important differences. To begin with, the system in Cambridge has a virtual population, so the population exists only on the CPU of a computer, of a simulator that runs the evolutionary algorithm, and robots are incarnated one by one. This robot arm only builds one robot at a time, puts it on a table, estimates the fitness, and then recycles the elements and makes a new robot. The system in Amsterdam is really different because it is a real population. The three robots coexist and can interact with each other. The fitness is evaluated in isolation in Cambridge, in a table which is completely empty. And it is evaluated in a shared environment in Amsterdam, where the robots can even bump into each other or benefit from what the other one is doing or suffer from what the other one is doing. Also, evolutionarily speaking, the selection is done by a centralized overseer, the main algorithm loop in Cambridge, whereas in our system, selection is done by the robots themselves. To use a natural analogy, in Cambridge, there is someone, the experimenter or the algorithm that tells which robot has to mate with which robot to produce a child. In our systems, the robot can like or not like each other and engage in a reproduction act. Last but not least, The Cambridge system is like all evolutionary algorithms out there, or almost all evolutionary algorithms out there, uses a synchronized reproduction and selection step. The number of birth and the number of death is always the same. If you produce 10 new robots, you have to throw away 10 old robots, and that means that the population size is always constant. Our system is much more natural in this respect because birth and death are not related to each other. Depending on whether you have more of either of them, the population can grow or shrink. So far, the good news about robot evolutionary systems in reality. Obviously, this robot baby project was not the end, it was only the start. So what's happening now? We continue the work and we are laying the groundwork, we are putting together the puzzle. We develop the technical and algorithmic know-how, and we are also seeking deeper understanding, patterns, relationships, and invariants of important effects. So what we also do, we identify the steps that an experimenter or a user needs to go through to build such a system. And such a system always starts with imagining the robots you want to have. The phenotypes. You want to have robots for replication in the jungle or under the sea or on Mars, you will have to come up with a different phenotype. Once you agree what kind of phenotypes you want, you have to find out what kind of genotypes can encode for these phenotypes, and you have to determine how to produce a phenotype from a genotype. In other words, you have to set up the production center, the birth clinic. Once you did that, and you identify the genotypes, you have to design the crossover and mutation operators that manipulate these genotypes and can create new robotic pieces of DNA. On the other side of the same coin, you have to define what the robot is supposed to be doing. So what kind of targets do you give? What skills do they have to exhibit? What tasks do they have to perform? How you define fitness or reward for learning? And once you do that, you can select based on task performance or fitness. You can decide which robots deserve to act as a parent, which robots deserve to survive, and which don't. And if you also want to improve the system on the short term, add adaptation on a not evolutionary but on an individual scale, then you also have to design learning methods, supervised learning or unsupervised learning, depending on the application. Those are the practical details, but there are also advantages for theory. So Josh Bongard and Rolf Fechter have a beautiful book which is called How the Body Shapes the Way We Think, or putting it shortly, How the Body Shapes the Mind. With this technology, bodies become shapeable as well. So we could invert the question and investigate how the mind shapes the body, or if you are a clear-minded thinker, how the body and the mind shape each other under certain environmental conditions. We could also investigate the effect of the environment on the result of evolution, the evolved morphologies, the evolved brains, and the evolved behavior. This is a fundamental thing in biology. We know that the environment is always determines what kind of life forms emerge there. It would be really interesting to investigate this in robots. Furthermore, we can combine evolutionary learning in completely new ways. There are quite some publications about such a combination because it is such a powerful combination. And here we have options, design choices. We could have a Darwinian system where individually acquired skills do not get inheritable. If you learn how to play football or violin or how to speak Hungarian, you cannot propagate these skills to your children by inheritance. You have to teach them because life on Earth is Darwinian. But in a robot evolution system, we can make it Lamarckian. And Lamarck was a biologist who thought that individually acquired properties are inheritable. So if a robot learns to perform a task very well, we could simply encode this skill into its genome, and thereby it is made inheritable. So the offspring of this robot will also have this skill. Finally, the big question, the evolution of intelligence. So here we are trying to find preconditions that are necessary for this to happen. We are trying to find attractors, states where evolution is always going to, or we are trying to find invariants, things that always happen, no matter what kind of course evolution is taking. To illustrate what we are seeking for instance, the shape of the evolutionary development curve. At the moment, we have no idea whether it starts very quickly and flattens out at the end, or quite the opposite, will it have a hockey stick shape, starting very slowly and rapidly accelerating the level of intelligence later on? Is it a linear process, or maybe it is a stepwise process? Stages of development and stages of stagnation, stages of development and stages of stagnation. At the moment, we don't know, and with robot evolution, we can investigate this question. And now let me share a couple of our results with you based on a few papers in the last years. Let me start with a paper that looks into a strange effect of the environment on the award morphologies, given our system and the fitness function, which only measures the speed of locomotion in a kind of gait learning setup. We found that on a flat landscape, the optimal body form is always a chain of modules, or snakes, if you will. So we did quite some investigations into changing the environment and putting obstacles in it or making it more difficult to navigate. But every time it were the snakes that wiped out all other forms because they could move more quickly. And it took us quite some effort to understand this and to design an environment where snakes were not the optimal life forms. The next question has a practical as well as theoretical relevance. And the question is how to evolve for a combined fitness, how to make sure that the evolved robots are fit for the environment and also fit for purpose, or putting it differently, that they are viable and useful. And the combination is very important, obviously, in any application where robots work out there in the real world. And the solution is based on a rather straightforward idea, observing that an evolutionary algorithm has two selection mechanisms. One selection mechanism is what is called mate selection or parent selection or sexual selection. And the other one is the environmental selection or survival selection. And given that we have two selection mechanisms and two objectives, we can simply distribute these objectives over these mechanisms. And we can indeed have a robot evolutionary process, which will end up in robots that are fit for the environment and fit for purpose. The third example I want to share with you is a small creative project that started off with a naive question being, what is more important for intelligent behavior, to have a good body or to have a good brain? And this question is indeed formulated in a naive way, but we succeeded in quantifying this question, turning it into a formal question that can be investigated empirically and experimentally. And we conducted these experiments and found out that in our robotic system, on a flat landscape, with fitness being the speed of locomotion, a body is more important than the brain. Finally, the good old question about learning and evolution. As I said before, the designer of an artificial evolutionary system has a choice. The designer or the experimenter can decide whether to use a Darwinian or a Lamarckian evolutionary mechanism. And in a paper last year, we looked into this in more detail and figured out that in our system, Lamarckian evolution is a much better idea. And I think that this is a generalizable result. We did not conduct other experiments yet, but I would suggest that if you are building such a system, you go for a Lamarckian version. But for now, in the lab, we are trying to realize the most elementary features and functionalities that robots need. To put it very simply, to make a robot system viable, each and every robot has to be able to move, eat, and mate. It has to be able to locomote, and then has to recharge itself, and it has to be engaged, it has to be able to engage in recombination and produce offspring. At the moment, we are at the very first step. So we are running robot evolutionary processes in simulations, and you see the result of a simulation on the left-hand side. Interestingly, the evolved robots sometimes resemble evolved animals. So we have biologists who assist our team and identify existing locomotion patterns and body morphology structures and tell us which animal has the same. We can also take this out of the simulator and then put it on a real robot. And on the right-hand side, you see the robot baby, which is moving around in the arena with a controller or brain that has been evolved in simulator. This opens up very interesting possibilities, because here the fitness is simply the speed of movement. If a robot can move ahead in a straight line quickly, then it is fit and then it will get offspring. But we could also do something completely different. We could also try to make the robots do something else. And that something else here in this demonstration is spinning around in 360 degrees around your own axis. You may say this is not a useful skill, but it is actually, because this would be the basis of search behavior. If a robot has to recharge itself, it has to look around and find the charging station and then walk to it and touch it and recharge itself with energy. The most substantial research effort today into robot evolution is a project in the UK with the collaboration from the Netherlands. It is the project called Autonomous Robot Evolution, Cradle to Grave. It's funded by the EPSRC and partly by my university, and it has the objective to build the first complete robot evolution system with all the stages of the triangle of life, all the modules of an evosphere implemented. On the left-hand side, you see an illustration of the robots as they look like in the ARE project. And on the right-hand side, you see a photo of the birth clinic. So let me show how it works. What you see here is a robotic arm that picks a component from what we call the organ bank, and it brings this organ into that location where the robot babies are composed. That green thing hanging from the ceiling is the robot baby under construction. And it is hanging because it is mechanically easier to assemble them like this. So this is a project that will take 4 years. We are in a year and a half to this project. We have 2 years and a half to go on. And I'm quite positive that we will indeed get there and produce a robot evolution system for a certain application, which is the decommissioning of nuclear power plants. In the meanwhile, the development of the conceptual frameworks is also continuing. About a year ago, the new journal Nature Machine Intelligence published a vision paper called Evolving Embodied Intelligence from Materials to Machines. The interesting thing about this is that it extends the framework with one level. It goes down one level, and rather than just simply evolving components and combinations of these components into robots, it looks at the level below that, and that is the level of materials. So materials with certain properties can be evolved or combined or selected for depending on what kind of functionalities are required in that application. And in this illustration, you see a lot of different kind of applications. For instance, we could have an application on a polar application, which would be wind powered, sliding locomotion. The robots must be water resistant and they could degrade with heat. Or completely the opposite, we could have a robot colony in the Sahara, which is again solar powered, sliding locomotion. It has to be heat resistant and degrades with UV light. All this will lead to robot evolutionary systems that can be roughly categorized into two very different clusters, whether the human is or is not in the loop. If the human is not in the loop, then we have fully autonomous robot systems, for instance, on Mars. If the human is in the loop, then we had a kind of breeding farms, robot breeding farms. So pretty much like farmers select animals for the properties that they prefer, a thick fur or much milk, or, you know, being big and mean, protecting the sheep. Robot evolvers can also do the same. Evolution doesn't have to be it all alone. So the users or the experimenters can observe the system and interfere with the system and select those robots that are performing well, maybe according to some implicit criteria that are not quantified and formalized, and make sure that evolution goes that way. So the human in the loop can accelerate and help evolution. The role of the human in a robot evolutionary system can also be used to make different categories of such systems. As you remember, there are two big components of any evolutionary process, selection and reproduction. And in both components, you could have the human in the loop or not. So the most simple system, perhaps, if the human is involved in both. So selection can be done or aided by humans, like the robot breeder, and reproduction can be also aided by humans, like my PhD students that put together a robot baby with the hand. And then you can go to systems where you remove the human from either of these, so type 2 and type 3 robot evolutionary systems have humanless autonomous reproduction, pretty much like the ARV project is trying to realize, or humanless selection, where robots really decide themselves when and with what other robot they want to reproduce. And if you combine these all, you will have the ultimate system of type 4, where humans are not needed for any of these steps. And in the near future, it is quite likely that we will have type 1 evospheres, robot breeding farms. By the end of the ARE project, we will have one. But maybe we can even go further and realize a type 2 or a type 3 system. My best guess is that in 5 to 15 years, this kind of supervised or semi-supervised systems will be present. To build fully autonomous type 4 robot evolutionary systems will take longer. My best guess is it may take 15 plus years. This will realize robot colonies for mining, terraforming, or even entertainment. When we are there, we will benefit from what I call second-order engineering, second-order software engineering, and second-order hardware engineering. And it is second order because rather than directly engineering a robot, we are engineering a system that is engineering a robot for us. And we can do it with the hardware and we can do it with the software. And the key to both is adaptation. And as a matter of fact, we have adaptation at two timescales. We have adaptation through two loops. Remember the triangle of life. So this described the overall system from conception to conception and a learning period in the infancy stage. This actually means that we have two adaptive processes working in parallel and interacting with each other. On the one hand, we have evolution that works over several generations. In real life, it could take thousands and thousands, millions of years to evolve something. An important thing to note about the evolutionary cycle is that it concerns the bodies and the brains, both the morphologies and the controllers. So indeed, every trial generates a new robot. A new robot does have a body and it does have a brain that will interact with each other and put in the environment where they are tested, evaluated, and may be used for reproduction. On the other hand, we have the learning loop, which is the blue circle here. It takes place in the stage of the infancy after the birth of a new robot. This means that the body is given, the body is of that new robot, and only the brain is brains are changing in every cycle. In technical terms, it means that in the learning process, every trial is the generation and the test of a new brain. So consecutively, during the lifetime of this robot with the given body, several brains are tested until we find a good one. In the current system, we did not include the possibility to apply lifetime learning to the bodies or the morphologies. This is not impossible, though. In biology, we have organisms that can change their bodies over a lifetime. Even we can change ours if we go to the gym. However, a robotic implementation at the current level of technology is really challenging, so we did not include it. If technology advances enough, we could have robots that can change their shapes, they become transformers, then we can also include it in the overall system. So this all amounts to a grand vision, details and ideas about implementation, and examples of working components of technology towards developing embodied intelligence. This is the technological relevance, but this can also be used for science. To me, an evosphere is not just a place that will build robots for us to be used. It is also a completely new scientific instrument. And what I mean is, if you want to study the stars, first you have to build a telescope. If you want to study nuclear particles, you have to build a cyclotron. And if you want to study evolution, then you build an evosphere. With this, with such a new instrument, you can do completely new kind of investigations into old questions of biologists. Would they be interested? Actually, they are interested. One of the most preeminent evolutionary biologists, John Maynard Smith, once noted, "So far, we have been able to study only one evolving system, and we cannot wait for interstellar flight to provide us with a second. If we want to discover generalizations about evolving systems, we have to look at artificial ones." Being able to do that will bring us to a big breakthrough. This will be a game changer also on historical scale. Considering the history of the notion of evolution back in centuries, we could note that in the 19th century, the notion of evolution was introduced by Darwin, and it described a process that has already taken place. It explains something that happened already, the evolution, the emergence of life. This is evolution in vivo, in vetver, that is the biosphere that you and me are part of. In the 20th century, there was this intention called the computer, which allowed us to build artificial worlds, virtual simulated worlds, and implement evolutionary principles in silico, in software. This is what we know as evolutionary computing. And the technology that my lab and some other labs and projects are working on will make the second big transition in the 21st century from software to hardware, from in silico to in material. And this will move the art and the technology from evolutionary computing to the evolution of things, rather than just the evolution of code. What will the evolution of things bring us? It is hard to say, but you could make a comparison between the wild dream of building flying machines and the wild dream of building evolving and self-reproducing machines. And it can take a couple of hundred years. So 500 years ago, there were wild dreamers who wanted to build flying machines, and they couldn't even argue what they were good for. They could never win a grant application because they couldn't write the section about the scientific or the societal relevance. But sure enough, they went for it, and today our life will not be our life if we didn't have the airline industry. Similarly, we have this wild dream of being evolving and self-reproducing machines, and in 500 years, it will lead to something. Of course, the future is hard to predict, but I'm quite sure about one thing. Artificial evolution will produce a robosphere, the technical equivalent of the biosphere. And this robosphere will have a fascinating diversity of ingenious, beautiful, and surprising creatures. We don't know what the robosphere will be like, but one thing is for sure. It will be life, but not life as we know it.